Oh, good morning, everyone. Can everybody hear me okay? Very good. It's such a delight to be with all of you and have our choir singing with us again, and Damien leading on the organ. And it's such a blessing, whether you're at home or here today, to be able to worship amongst God's people. Everything you need for today's service is found either in your service orders, if you're here in person and on the screens, and if you're at home and you have a computer with you, then you'll see the slides there on your screen as well. We are on the fifth Sunday of Lent, and Holy Week, I can't believe Holy Week is almost here. The highlight of our Christian year. And today, as we journey on towards the cross, Sonia will be preaching for us in our series, The Suffering Savior. And we're going to hear a little bit more about our natures, the depth of our natures and the flaws that are there and what Jesus has to say about it and what he has, most importantly, to do about it. So again, you are very welcome just as you are, and are going to invite you to now turn to one another and to greet one another. Our opening hymn this morning is Speak, O Lord. Let's sing. Please sit or kneel to pray. Almighty God, to whom all hearts are
open, all desires known, and from whom no secrets are hidden. Cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name. Through Christ our Lord. Amen.
God spoke these words and said, I am the Lord your God. You shall have no other gods but me. Lord, have mercy upon us. Incline our hearts to keep this law. You shall not make for yourself any idol, whether in the form of anything that is in heaven above, or that is on the earth beneath, or that is in the water under the earth. You shall not bow down to them or worship them. Lord, have mercy upon us, and incline our hearts to keep this law. You shall not take the name of the Lord your God in vain. Lord, have mercy upon us, and incline our hearts to keep this law. Remember the Sabbath day, and keep it holy. For 6 days you shall labor and do all your work, but the seventh day is the Sabbath of the Lord your God. Lord, have mercy upon us, and incline our hearts to keep this law. Honor your father and your mother. Lord, have mercy upon us, and incline our hearts to keep this law. You shall not murder. Lord, have mercy upon us, and incline our hearts to keep this law. You shall not commit adultery. Lord, have mercy upon us, and incline our hearts to keep this law. You shall not steal. Lord, have mercy upon us, and incline our hearts to keep this law. You shall not bear false witness. Have mercy upon us, and incline our hearts to keep this law. You shall not covet. Have mercy upon us, and write all these your laws in our hearts. Pray for grace to keep Lent faithfully. Gracious Father, you gave up your Son out of love for the world. Lead us to ponder the mysteries of his passion, that we may know eternal peace through the shedding of our Savior's blood. Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. Almighty and everlasting God, you hate nothing that you have made, and forgive the sins of all those who are penitent. Create and make in us new and contrite hearts, that we, worthily lamenting our sins and acknowledging our wretchedness, may receive from you, the God of all mercy, perfect remission and forgiveness. Through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who is alive and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen.
reading from Philippians chapter 3, beginning at the 4th verse. If someone else thinks they have reasons to put confidence in the flesh, I have more. Circumcised on the 8th day, of the people of Israel, of the tribe of Benjamin, a Hebrew of Hebrews, in regard to the law, a Pharisee, as for zeal, persecuting the church, as for righteousness based on the law, faultless. But whatever were gains to me, I now consider loss for the sake of Christ. What is more, I consider everything a loss because of the surpassing worth of knowing Christ Jesus my Lord, for whose sake I have lost all things. I consider them garbage, that I may gain Christ and be found in him, not having a righteousness of my own that comes from the law, but that which is through faith in Christ, the righteousness that comes from God on the basis of faith. I want to know Christ, yes, to know the power of his resurrection and participation in his sufferings, becoming like him in his death, and so somehow attaining to the resurrection from the dead. Not that I have already obtained all this or have already arrived at my goal, but I press on to take hold of that for which Christ Jesus took hold of me. Brothers and sisters, I do not consider myself yet to have taken hold of it, but one thing I do, forgetting what is behind and straining towards what is ahead, I press on towards the goal to win the prize for which God has called me heavenwards in Christ Jesus. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
A reading from Psalm 126. When the Lord restored the fortunes of Zion, we were like those who dreamed. Our mouths were filled with laughter, our tongues with songs of joy. Then it was said among the nations, the Lord has done great things for them. The Lord has done great things for us, and we are filled with joy. Restore our fortunes, Lord, like streams in the Negev. Those who sow with tears will reap with songs of joy. Those who go out weeping, carrying seed to sow, will return with songs of joy, carrying sheaves with them. Glory to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit.
As it was in the beginning, is now, and ever shall be, world without end. Amen.
Gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ according to John chapter 12, beginning at the first verse. Glory to you, O Lord. 6 days before the Passover, Jesus came to Bethany, where Lazarus lived, whom Jesus had raised from the dead. Here a dinner was given in Jesus' honor. Martha served, while Lazarus was among those reclining at the table with him. Then Mary took a pint of pure nard, an expensive perfume. She poured it on Jesus' feet and wiped his feet with her hair. And the house was filled with the fragrance of the perfume. But one of his disciples, Judas Iscariot, who was later to betray him, objected. Why wasn't this perfume sold and the money given to the poor? It was worth a year's wages. He did not say this because he cared about the poor, but because he was a thief. As keeper of the money bag, he used to help himself to what was put into it. Leave her alone, Jesus replied. It was intended that she should save this perfume for the day of my burial. You will always have the poor among you, but you will not always have me. This is the gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, O Christ.
Standing as we are, in confidence and trust, let us proclaim our faith in the words of the Nicene Creed. Do you believe and trust in God the Father? We believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. Do you believe and trust in His Son, Jesus Christ? We believe in one Lord, Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, from the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation he came down from heaven, was incarnate from the Holy Spirit and the Virgin Mary, and was made man. For our sake he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day he rose again in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. Do you believe and trust in the Holy Spirit? We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son is worshipped and glorified, who has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy Catholic and Apostolic Church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen.
Of my mouth and the meditations of my heart be pleasing in your sight, O Lord, my rock and my redeemer. Amen. Please be seated. Good morning, everyone. It's so wonderful to be here with all of you today and to be inspired by the music of our choir. Last week, when Mark preached on the prodigal son, he looked not just at the son that returned, but also the son that remained. And looking at a different person involved in the story made me reflect today. We usually pay attention to Mary anointing Jesus, but what if we looked at Judas? And what if we looked at ourselves? So in today's gospel, we find ourselves in Bethany, at the home of Jesus' friends, Mary, Martha, and Lazarus. We are at the end of Jesus' ministry. It's Friday, 1 week before Jesus' crucifixion. The next day, Jesus will enter Jerusalem for the last time. He has stopped just outside the city, in the town of Bethany, to have a Sabbath meal amongst his closest and dearest friends. Once again, we see Martha welcoming, feeding a large group of men, and once again, we see her sister Mary sitting with Jesus. We are not aware of the conversations or the circumstances, and we don't know what encouraged Mary to act. But in a moment of prophecy, she pours a liter of perfumed anointing oil on Jesus' feet, then humbles herself before him and exposed her hair in front of men, and she wipes his feet with her hair. Through this act, Mary is recognizing Jesus as the Messiah and demonstrates her understanding of what is to come. After all, she has been listening to all he said and taught for years. She understands that this is the end of his ministry and that she is sending him off for his suffering and death. And in response to this profound moment, Judas comments about the cost. This opposition from Judas must have been painful for Jesus. When Mary pours the perfumed oil on Jesus' feet, Jesus objects. Why wasn't this perfume sold and the money given to the poor? It's worth a year's wages. This, on the face of it, is a perfectly good objection. But we read, he did not say this because he cared about the poor. It must have been so distressing for Jesus that his friend and disciple Judas was in fact stealing money from the gifts made to Jesus and his disciples by generous donors. Jesus simply responds to Judas's objections. You will always have the poor among you, but you will not always have me. Jesus was certainly not encouraging complacency about the poor. The fact that we will never obliterate poverty in the world does not mean that we should not try. After all, compassion for the poor was central to Jesus's ministry. Rather, Jesus was turning the attention of his disciples to the significance of what Mary had done. Clearly, Mary understands who Jesus is, but the 12 disciples, those men who had for 3 years learned at Jesus' feet, aided in his ministry, witnessed the resurrection of Lazarus, and also stood witness to every other miracle of Jesus, once again, were not understanding. And at this point in Jesus' ministry, where he's approaching his death, they are questioning what Mary has done. So, somewhere in my mind, perhaps because I've always seen the 12 depicted in statues with halos or portrayed as saints, painted as larger-than-life icons, I assumed a level of perfection in these men that scripture tells me just isn't there. These 12 men are flawed, fully ordinary men of their times, but it was in their willingness to respond to the call to follow Jesus that set them apart. We know from scripture that Jesus was often frustrated and exasperated with these 12. I can imagine him teaching, sitting on the beach, facepalm. Do you still not understand? Jesus would say, and then say, okay, let me explain it a different way. They very often seemed to miss the point. Peter, the rock Jesus would build his church on, disowned Jesus at a critical moment, but then he was also the one whose words the Holy Spirit used to convert thousands on the day of Pentecost. James and John asked Jesus to do whatever they asked. They wanted to be Jesus's number one and number two, to sit at his left and his right, not understanding they were asking to follow him in death. But Jesus still trusted them to look after and care for his mother once he died. Philip doubted that Jesus could feed the 5,000. Bartholomew needed to see a sign of Jesus' divinity before declaring he was God. And Thomas, forever known as the doubter, needed to see to believe. Matthew, the tax collector, generally those in that profession were not well thought of in communities. Probably the wealthiest of the 12, the one who was leaving the most behind to follow Jesus, but also probably hated in his community. He made money from taking extra in taxes, but who was wholly loved and accepted by Jesus. Simon the Zealot, much like the Pharisees, had a legalistic approach to the word of God. And finally, Judas, synonymous with traitor now, may have been considered good with money or trustworthy because somehow he wound up being the designated treasurer for Jesus and his disciples, and ironically was completely untrustworthy. Why did our Lord choose these men? Could there have been no one better? But then, Jesus never asked them or any of us to be perfect. How often have I been Peter denying Jesus at work or in social situations? How often I have been Thomas doubting the gospel message because I had not seen? How often have I been Judas being untrustworthy or betraying our Lord by my actions? Our Savior took on suffering and death for all their sins and ours, not to make us perfect, but to show us a way to redemption. The 12 disciples of Jesus were not any better than any of us, neither were they any worse. They were of humankind, living their lives as most people do, living in a world of challenge and defeat, traditions and non-understandable attitudes, living with its joys and sorrows, in the midst of many beliefs, searching for the one truth, and by God's providence, finding Jesus in their midst. They were not men of great education, capability of understanding, high ethics, or superior morals, or men who were renowned for their great acts. They were men who lacked stature or wealth, the measure by which the world sees success. They certainly lacked the qualifications for the calling they had received from God. But these men, as flawed as they were, went on with purpose and passion and perseverance to turn the world upside down. The proof of their capabilities is in the church which has prevailed. What sets them, and now us, apart is the willingness to pick up our cross and follow Jesus. Together, as we approach the sorrow of Good Friday and the joy of the resurrection on Easter Sunday, spend some time in reflection, the areas where Jesus might be looking down on you, face in hand, saying, "Do you still not understand? Let me show you a different way." Amen.
God has been so kind to us. He's been so kind to us as a community, as individuals in our own ways. Even in the midst of our sufferings, the love of God never leaves us. And as he's been generous to us, we also, as people who follow Jesus, are called to be generous to others. Now's a moment where we practice that in real time with the blessings of money which God has given to us to give back to him and to his world. So this is, of course, not an obligation, but it's part of what we do as Christians, as we learn how to be generous. So whether you're here or at home, you're very welcome to take part in this ministry of generosity. In just a moment, we'll have a plate that will be passed here at the church physically, and if you're at home today, those that are in the practice of mailing a check or checking out our website for a variety of different ways to give, however it is that you choose to do so. We are so grateful for this ministry of generosity. Let's now, as we collect our offerings, stand together and sing Fairest Lord Jesus. Gracious God, all things come from you, and you teach us to be generous with what we have. We pray that our gifts may be wisely used for the ministry of the gospel and the relief of those in need, for the glory of our Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. Now, would you either sit or kneel as we pray together?
Please respond to the petition, Lord, in your mercies, with the response, hear our prayer. Lord, in your mercies. Everlasting God, you call us to your service. So we ask that you make us worthy of your calling and to hear us when we intercede and give thanks to you through Jesus Christ, your Son. Lord, in your mercies. Amen. Holy God, as we gather for worship in a place that is not ours, but yours, we thank you for joining together for this community of St. Mary and St. Martha. Encourage us all to serve you as you deserve, putting aside that which divides us and healing any division so that we may stay on the path towards your kingdom. Lord, in your mercies. Amen. Creator God, we pray for the nations of the world and for their right dealing with one another. Especially we pray for Russia and the Ukraine, that hostility will cease and a declaration of peace will prevail. May barriers of races, creed, gender, and color be broken, and political freedom established where there is oppression and suppression of new ideas. We pray for educational development and for a more just economy, economic structure which pays people fairly for their labor. Lord, in your mercies. Amen. And Father God, we thank you that no matter how widely spread throughout the world our families may our hearts be joined together in prayer. We also thank you for the means of modern technology, that we are able to communicate and keep us closely in touch with those whom we love, which means we are not only heard by their love, but we can also see our loved ones. Lord, in your mercies. And gracious God, mercifully look down upon us and our lives. And we pray especially for those whose lives are shattered by illness. Help them and those who care for them to be free from resentment and give them the strength to seek your will, whatever it might be and in every situation. Today, remembering Sam and his family, remembering Jonathan, remembering Wayne, remembering Cynthia, remembering Sheila. And at this time, I invite you to take a moment and offer up healing or grace for those who are on your heart, either silently or aloud. Lord, in your mercies. Merciful God, remember the slenderness of the thread which separates life from death and the suddenness in which it can be broken. Help us also to remember whatever occurs in life, we are surrounded by your love. Help those bereaved by loss of loved ones to find your love and peace and reassurance. At this time, remember Anne Brown family, John Bullingman family, Dorothy Smythe, and again I invite you to offer up a moment of silence for those whom you've loved and those who have gone on before you. Lord, in your mercies. Amen. Eternal God, giver of love and power, your Son Jesus has sent us into the world to preach the gospel of his kingdom. Confirm us with his mission and help us to live the good news we proclaim in all what we do and say. Merciful Father, accept these prayers for the sake of our Son Jesus Christ, our Savior.
Amen.
My brothers and sisters, if anyone sins, we have an advocate with the Father, Jesus Christ the righteous, and he is the propitiation for our sins, and not for ours only, but also for the sins of the whole world. In penitence and faith, let us confess our sins. Almighty God, Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, maker of all things, judge of all, we acknowledge and confess our many sins, which we have committed in thought, word, and deed, against your divine majesty. We earnestly repent and are truly sorry for all our misdoings. Have mercy on us, most merciful Father, for your Son, our Lord Jesus Christ's sake. Forgive us all that is past, and grant that from now on we may always serve and please you in lives wholly renewed by your Spirit, to the honor and glory of your name, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Almighty God, our Heavenly Father, who in his great mercy has promised forgiveness of sins to all who turn to him with heartfelt repentance and true faith, have mercy upon you, pardon and deliver you from all your sins. Confirm and strengthen you in all goodness, and bring you to eternal life through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Merciful Father, turn us from sin to faithfulness and from disobedience to love, and prepare us to celebrate the death and resurrection of Christ our Savior, who is alive and reigns now and forever. Amen. Listen to our Lord Jesus Christ's words of assurance to all who truly turn to him. Come to me, all you who are weary and burdened, and I will give you rest. For God so loved the world that he gave his one and only Son, that whoever believes in him shall not perish but have eternal life. The Apostle Paul says, here is a trustworthy saying that deserves full acceptance. Christ Jesus came into the world to save sinners. The Apostle John also says, if anybody does sin, we have one who speaks to the Father in our defense, Jesus Christ, the righteous one. He is the atoning sacrifice for our sins. The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is indeed right and good to give you thanks and praise, Almighty God, our everlasting Father, through Jesus Christ, your Son. For in these 40 days, you lead us into the desert of repentance, that through a pilgrimage of prayer and discipline, we may grow in grace and learn to be your people once again. Through fasting, prayer, and acts of service, you bring us back to your generous heart. Through study of your holy word, you open our eyes to your presence in the world and free our hands to welcome others into the radiant splendor of your love. As we prepare to celebrate the Easter feast with joyful hearts and minds, we bless you for your mercy, and join with saints and angels forever praising you and singing. Almighty God, our Heavenly Father, in your tender mercy you gave your only Son, Jesus Christ, to suffer death upon the cross for our redemption. He made thereby his once and for all offering of himself a full, perfect, and sufficient sacrifice for the sins of the whole world. He instituted and in his holy gospel commands us to continue a perpetual memory of his precious death until he comes again. Hear us, O merciful Father, we humbly pray, and grant that we who receive this bread and this wine, according to your Son Jesus Christ's holy institution, in remembrance of his death and passion, may be partakers of his most blessed body and blood. On the night that Jesus was betrayed, he took bread. And when he had given thanks, he broke it. And he gave it to his disciples, saying, take and eat. "This is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." In the same way, after supper, Jesus took the cup. And when he had given thanks, he gave it to them, saying, "Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it, in remembrance of me." Accept through Jesus Christ, our great high priest, this our sacrifice of praise and thanksgiving. And as we eat and drink these holy gifts, grant by the power of the life-giving Spirit that we may be made one in your holy church and partakers of the body and blood of your Son, that he may dwell in us and we in him. Through the same Jesus Christ, our Lord, by whom and with whom and in whom, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all honor and glory are yours, Almighty Father, forever and ever. Amen. Since we are justified by faith, we have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ, who has given us access to his grace. The peace of the Lord be always with you. We do not presume to come to this your table, merciful Lord, trusting in our own righteousness, but in your abundant and great mercies. We are not even worthy to gather up the crumbs under your table, but you are the same Lord who delights in showing mercy. Grant us therefore, gracious Lord, so to eat this bread and to drink this wine, that our bodies and souls may be cleansed by Christ's body and blood, and that we may evermore dwell in him and he in us. Amen. People who are joining online today, the Book of Common Prayer affirms that during circumstances such as the ones we are living in with right now, we can receive the sacrament in our hearts by faith and with thanksgiving as an act of spiritual communion. In that way, we can continue to participate in the body and blood of Jesus Christ. And now I would invite you to join with me in a prayer of spiritual communion. Thanks be to you, Lord Jesus Christ, for all the benefits you have given me, for all the pains and insults you have borne for me. Since I cannot now receive you sacramentally, I ask you to come spiritually into my heart. O most merciful Redeemer, friend and brother, may I know you more clearly, love you more dearly, and follow you more nearly, day by day. Amen. For those who are here in person today, we would be delighted to share with you from the table in the bread in one kind. And the way in which we receive will happen in this way, that you'll see on the right-hand side of the aisle, there are strips of yellow tape, and that's to give us spacing between one another. And we will receive the bread at the solid yellow line near the foot of the stairs. Please keep your mask on at all times at this point. Receive the bread, and you would head back to your pew where you would lower your mask to consume the bread. Let's now, my brothers and sisters, gather at the Lord's table. Lord Jesus, remember us in your kingdom and teach us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Almighty God, you have given us your only Son to be for us both a sacrifice for sin and also an example of godly life. Give us grace that we may always most thankfully receive these his inestimable gifts, and also daily endeavor to follow the blessed steps of his most holy life. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. God of our pilgrimage, you have fed us with the bread of heaven. Refresh and sustain us as we go forward on our journey. In the name of Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen and amen. Lord Jesus, you have taught us that what we do for the least of our brothers and sisters, we do also for you. Give us the will to be the servant of others, as you were the servant of all, and gave up your life and died for us, but are alive and reign now and forever. Amen. And now may Christ give you grace to grow in holiness, to deny yourselves, to take up your cross and follow him, and the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be amongst you and remain with you, now and always. Amen. Well, once again, good morning, everyone. Thank you, choir, for singing for us and inspiring us. Thank you, Damien, for your leadership on the organ and for being here today. A special welcome to those who are new or visiting with us, either here or at home. If you have any questions about life and ministry at St. Mary and St. Martha, we'd be really happy to speak with you. Please contact the office if you'd like to set up a conversation, or if you're here in person today, just grab anybody, not literally, that's wearing something like this or has a name tag, and we'd be happy to connect with you. That means you too, choir, because you're dressed like this. Now that we are reopening, things are opening up more and more, this means that our ministry of welcome becomes that much more important. So our welcome teams are going to be restarting. And I would ask that you would please reach out to Michael if you would like to participate. And we're going to be connecting with all those who have previously served on teams in the coming weeks. So stay tuned for that. And as we come closer to Holy Week, we are excited about this. We have a kids program for Good Friday and Easter Sunday. And what we're going to do this year is have it completely in person. So there are fun physical activities to do. So we want to have this all in person as much as possible. So spread the word and get any friends and family to come and join with us on Good Friday and Easter Sunday. So those lessons and activities will be in the form of adapted Stations of the Cross. And for Easter Sunday, we're going to be making a special communal craft focusing on the Easter story. And following the service, there's going to be an Easter egg hunt. So that should be fun. Is this for everybody or is it just for the kids? Kids? Okay, does that mean like older kids? Like we're all God's children, so yeah, that's right. Okay, so I guess we'll have to restrain ourselves you see an egg on the ground, don't touch it. Also in Holy Week, at the beginning, we have palm cross making. And if you've never done it, it's actually a lot of fun. It's meditative, and it's also a way to build relationships with one another and be in fellowship. So on April the 9th at 10:30 in the parish hall, we'll have some palm cross making. So feel free to come to that. We'd love to have you join with us. The last thing to mention is that the Stations of the Cross installation in the parish hall is now set up. And this is to help us in our Lenten journey of pilgrimage. So each station has a featured moment in the last walk of Jesus towards the cross. And there are prayers that are associated with it and scripture. So I'd very much encourage you to check that out in the parish hall right now, where you can see on the wall stations there where you can journey along. So if you'd like to come into the parish hall, have a sit-down reception, some coffee and tea, and then pray with the stations, we'd love to join with you in that. So those are our announcements for today. Our closing hymn for today is 345, King of Glory, King of Peace. Would you please stand and
this is love, not that we loved God. He loved us and sent his Son. He is the sacrifice for our sins, that we might live through him. If God loves us so much, we ought to love one another. If we love one another, God lives in us. Go in peace to love and serve the Lord. In the name of Christ, amen.